This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey, everybody. This is Razib again with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast. And I am here today with a very eminent guest, Sir Walter Fred Bodmer, Dr. Bodmer. So I think it's the first knight that I have on the podcast. He is a fellow of the Royal Society. He is a professor at Oxford. He has been a professor at Stanford. He was one of the latest students of Sir Ronald Fisher. He worked with Joshua Lederberg and so forth and so on. And I do want to mention, in addition to his extensive range of publications, he has a book that he co-authored, The Genetics of Human Populations, which I have in front of me right now. This is not on video, so none of you see it, but trust me, I am not lying. So we're going to be talking about a lot of things, so I want to get right into it, Dr. Bodmer. You were, I think, one of Fisher's last students. You got your Ph.D. in 1959. There's been a lot of stuff about Fisher in the news, and for the listeners, there are going to be only a few of you, I hope, who don't know who Ronald Fisher is, R.A. Fisher, one of the founders, arguably the founder of modern statistics in the 20th century, also one of the founders of population genetics, the field of population genetics, with Sewell Wright, J.B.S. Haldane, and a few others, but probably eminent in that field. So there is an old joke that, Fisher is one of those guys who's famous with statisticians and also famous with biologists. And not all the statisticians know of his fame in biology and vice versa, although they probably should. In any case, so a very influential figure who made huge contributions. But recently, there has been some issues around his work, his views. If you read Genetical Theory of Natural Selection, which was written in the 1920s, I think it came out in 29, the second half of the book does concern itself with what they would call eugenical issues in the first half of the 20th century. And Fisher had a very keen interest in eugenics. And obviously, when I say the word eugenics, some of you are probably quite alarmed. You are not the only ones. So there have been recent attempts to remove Fisher's name, I think, from various awards and de-emphasize him. And I know a lot of geneticists, privately and publicly, think he is like the term of art in 2022 is problematic. There are other people who want to defend his legacy. Sidebar, like I know that, people who use Fisher's methods extensively in some of their papers. Recently, there was a paper a friend of mine was involved in, and they actually wanted to publish a note why they used Fisher's methods, even though he was not a good person. I only know about this because my friend basically said that he would not be associated with the paper if they wrote that note, and they eventually pulled it off. But so this is a huge issue that is coming up more and more. And I want to talk to Dr. Bodmer, as one of Fisher's last students, about the R.A. Fisher he knew. Fisher lived many, many decades ago. And so now, we access him through biographies and his letters, and there's different opinions about him. One thing that I have read is that he could be a difficult person to interact with. And sometimes if someone is difficult, not always congenial, that may color people's perceptions of them. I just want to know, Dr. Bodmer, what was your experience with Fisher as a human being? And then we can talk about your opinion on the recent goings on with Fisher and his legacy.
Well, let me first say how I got from being a mathematics student to doing genetics. Because I think that gives a bit of background and also helps to explain the way that I got to know Fisher. And the reason was that in my second year doing mathematics, which one could do then for the main degree, Sir David Cox, a very notable statistician who sadly died recently, gave an excellent course, introductory course for mathematicians in statistics on the whole, the mathematicians were not too impressed with statistics as part of their subject. And in this, he mentioned Fisher. So I'd been thinking I might want to do statistics, but in order to take part in Fisher's lectures to the third year mathematicians on mathematical genetics, I felt I ought to learn something about this subject of genetics, which I'd never heard about. So I read a textbook on genetics, and I was given, amongst others, Fisher's famous book on the genetical theory of natural selection, just as a bit of light reading over the summer. And I became totally fascinated with the idea of genetics as something that one could do, that was tractable, had analytical sides to it. And that's what switched my interest totally eventually from both statistics and, of course, mathematics to genetics. And so I took his lecture courses in the third year of doing my maths degree. And within weeks, I decided he was the man I wanted to do my PhD with. And he was not at all a difficult person to get on with. He was remarkably considerate and kind, especially to younger people. When I was a young student there and I'd hardly heard about him, I would sometimes walk back from the lectures with him to his college at Gonville and Caius, because in some ways he was a bit of a lonely man, and he enjoyed these contacts. So he of course could be difficult with you if you decided to disagree with him, but that's another matter. So that was really my introduction to Fisher, and all my contacts with him in every way. On the one hand, that he's one of the most extraordinary scientists of the 20th century, both for his contributions to statistics and genetics. On the other hand, as really a very decent human being. He would love to be with children. He was always very friendly. He was enormously stimulating as a teacher. He suggested problems to you, and then when you solved them, he didn't put his name on your paper. So I don't know where a lot of these other ideas just come from. People have no idea of what he was like as a person, and mostly have no idea about his science. So that's a background. I don't know where you want me to go next, but I can certainly comment on all this cancellation business.
So let us comment on that. So you did. I just want to note for the listener, and I'll put a link in the show notes. You wrote, you co-authored, you were first author, Outstanding Scientist R.A. Fisher, His Views on Eugenics and Race. That was published more than a year ago now in Heredity. So there's been a lot of discussion. Can you use that as a starting point? Okay, so for Americans, most people don't know the word eugenics too well, aside from kind of like, let's just call it a slur or an insult or a, you know, you're pointing to the Nazis here. The British, they have a different experience with eugenics, the term. And can you contextualize that for the listener in terms of Fisher's involvement?
I'm extraordinarily surprised that you say eugenics wouldn't be known in the States. Eugenics was a much more severe activity in many ways in the United States, with Davenport, one of the early founders of Cold Spring Harbor, with compulsory sterilization proposed of people who had abnormalities that affected mental behavior, for example, in 28 states of the United States. So eugenics was a very active activity in the States. But let me go back a bit. Maybe people don't know the origin of eugenics. There was a very famous British statistician, come geneticist, come scientist, called Sir Francis Galton, to whom we owe the idea of how you use correlation and the use of normal distributions, as we call them, Gaussian distributions, to describe many distributions that you find in the natural world. And it was he that coined the term eugenics, I think it was in 1983, with the idea that one should find ways of improving the human stock by selective breeding of those who in some sense were superior, and superiority mostly related, if you really looked at it, to academic ability or leadership ability. And in the early years of the 20th century, there was a society founded, the Eugenics Society, And Fisher was active in that and active in initiating a similar society in the Cambridge University, where he was a student at Caius College. And people have somehow created an image of eugenics as something that's just terrible, and anybody who even talked about it was awful, which is simply wrong. And they've equated eugenics with the extremes of racism that you get from Hitler's Nazis who had the Holocaust and killed off Jews, or that you get with the extremes of the consequences of slavery, which in many ways were much more severe in their consequences in the United States than they were in the UK. So the first thing I would say about this whole area, and you know, Fisher is only one of many people, a very famous biologist of the 19th century, Thomas Huxley, who was really the founder of Imperial College and a key person to emphasize the need to educate everybody as much as possible. And he's been accused of being a racist too, and that's it's just extraordinary. There seems to be a group of people who want to find the slightest statement that anybody says as a way of fulfilling their beliefs that they must somehow be evil. I want to start with the statement that even if someone has done things that you wouldn't want them to do, or you wouldn't want to support them doing, if they've been outstanding in various ways, people still listen to Wagner's music, although he was an extreme anti-Semite. People still read Shakespeare, who wrote The Merchant of Venice, which was an extremely anti-Jewish play, as was appropriate in the times of Queen Elizabeth I's reign. And yet we don't discard Wagner's music, and we don't not read Shakespeare. And neither should we say, even if we don't like some of the things that Fisher did, that we should ignore his extraordinary contributions to statistics that underlie really all the modern ways that one will look at analysis of data that have contributed in their various ways to saving millions of lives. And nor should one discount his extraordinary contributions to genetics, as you mentioned, population genetics, to actually showing how the ideas of Mendelian genetics could be very well explained as being compatible with Darwin's evolution. Theory of evolution by natural selection, which he extraordinarily expounded with an inadequate theory of inheritance. So that's my first point. My second point would be that there is this wish, which I've also mentioned, to sort of denigrate people. I mean, another very distinguished geneticist of a different generation whom I knew well, Jim Crow, has recently been attacked by his colleagues at Wisconsin University in a way I find quite incredible, having known him extremely well. He was the most sensitive and reasonable and nice person and an excellent scientist. So there is this wish to exaggerate what people have done. So let's just say a little bit about Fisher then. Fisher, he was very concerned, as many people were into the 1930s and earlier, that there was a decline in the birth rate, and he reckoned, and with some evidence, that this was particularly true amongst what you might call the upper classes, which he did not define by their inherited nobility or anything. He defined purely on the basis of ability and leadership. And so there was a feeling that, and that's what his idea in the genetical theory of natural selection, he had an interesting, if strange, idea that the demise of civilizations was due to the fact that the people who were good leaders didn't have enough children, and they were outbred by the people who wouldn't be good leaders, who had more children and didn't have the same genetic capacity for that. And it was not an entirely stupid idea. The only way that he actually promoted eugenics was in arguing, and in a way that was supported by a very considerate government body that looked into this, the idea that there should be voluntary sterilization for people who suffered from severe genetic abnormalities, especially those that involved mental behavior. And that's as far as he went with his eugenics ideas. And you cannot say that that makes him then a racist in the sense of being anti-black or an anti-Semite if you're amongst the Nazis. And it's extraordinary that distinguished historians, including a Regius Professor of History in Cambridge, have distorted his views to such an extent that they've argued that he supported compulsory sterilization, which was absolutely not true. Now, one could go into other details. He had some communication with a German human geneticist who undoubtedly had Nazi connections, and he was accused, therefore, of being a supporter of the Nazis, although, you know, he had me as a student who was an actual escapee from Hitler's Nazism because I'm half Jewish, and he had a Jewish assistant that he supported very strongly. He had very close contacts with people in India. He was in no way that we can think of a racist in any sort of context that one would think of now. And so I find this idea that because of that, you take down a window at Caius College or you do something else is ridiculous. Now, I'm not saying that one shouldn't consider people's attitudes, but take into account the time when they had those attitudes. If you take this attitude about eugenic type things, or you take that attitude about slavery, there would be no distinguished scientist, including Darwin in the 19th century, whom you couldn't argue something about. So I think it's a very misguided approach, and it doesn't help anyone to solve the problems we have nowadays of inadequate consideration of equality between different ethnic groups as a function of their skin color or anything else, their religion or otherwise. So I think that's where I'd stop on that. I could go on longer and longer, but I hope you thought I've given you enough about that.
Yeah. No, I want to ask you, so I think many people in the audience have probably had an experience where, you know, they have, say, a personal experience with an individual, or they were in a situation or in a place, and then they see a representation in the media or in a book that's a total variance what their own personal expectations were or experience was. So I wanted to ask you concretely, because there are very few people in the world today who can say, I mean, you, AWF Edwards, a few other people now who had a personal experience on a professional and a personal level with R.A. Fisher. That's why I want to ask you, you know, my own personal opinions. I mean, I think the listeners will know pretty much in alignment with yours. You know, I do find it that this idea that our intellectual, you know, ancestors, the people that influenced us, that shaped our world, that you know, they would be someone we align with as human beings, a little interesting. I mean, you know, John Maynard Keynes famously got, when he got Newton's papers, Isaac Newton's papers, he called him the last of the Sumerians, because it turned out that in his free time. Yeah.
John Maynard Keynes was a very active member of the Eugenics Society, as at one time also was J.B.S. Haldane.
Yes. So Haldane himself. I mean, you know, this is like a who's who. It was a very mainstream view a century ago. And so I would ask the listener who is sitting in judgment to consider what views and what things that they do that a century from now, you know, contemporaries of that time might find abhorrent, and, you know, have a little historical perspective here. But that's just, you know, my opinion editorializing. So, and I wanted to give Dr. Bodmer his, you know, chance to speak on this. And I will link to his piece about historical perspective on Fisher. But so speaking of population genetics, I want to cut really quickly. So, you know, I haven't had too many people on this podcast who have your historical perspective, you know, in terms of your publication record, how far back it goes, how many people you've known. You know, I mentioned Lederberg, the geneticist, the biologist in the audience will know who that is. And then, you know, you obviously worked with also Cavalli-Sforza, Luke L.L. Cavalli-Sforza, who passed away several years ago, who I interviewed and who greatly influenced my own thinking in the 1990s and later. I want to ask about, like, the fundamentals of population genetics, of evolutionary genetics, and how we understand change over time. So, you know, what I was taught was, okay, if you think about evolutionary genetics, it's the allele frequencies, the genetic variants over time. They're shaped by these parameters like selection, mutation, drift, and migration. And this is a framework that's extremely old. That's, you know, a century old, if you think about it, to the origins of population genetics, origins of genetics itself. And now we have all this genomic data, and we're tracking the movements in various lineages, various species. Can I ask you, what is your perspective in terms of what we've learned about these dynamics over the last couple of decades with the empirical tools that we have since the molecular revolution and now the genomic revolution?
Well, let me first say that I think the basic ideas of how you use genetic variation to compare differences between different ethnic groups, between different human groups, have not really changed that much. You're looking at the spectrum of frequencies of genetic variants in different population groups and measuring the relationship between them by how similar or different that spectrum is. That idea was there with Otto Fischer, and it was there in the early days when you just had blood groups and when Anthony Edwards and Luca Cavalli-Sforza, my colleague and friend who, as you mentioned, died recently, first put together the idea that from that information, you could actually form an evolutionary tree that related the different major branches of human populations that was remarkably accurate. What's changed, and changed dramatically, is the detail with which you can look at a large number of variants. In Fischer's day, you hardly could look even at protein variants. And now suddenly with the DNA revolution came the possibility of looking at an almost infinite number, nothing can be infinite, but millions of variants. So you can get much deeper information about relationships. And I would quote from that the study, which I think it was really a pioneering study that we've done in the UK, called People of the British Isles, that was done with my colleagues, Peter Donnelly and others, in which we were able for the first time to use detailed genetic investigations of carefully chosen people representative of the places from where they came from in the British Isles based on their ancestry, that at least four of their grandparents came from more or less the same part of the country where they live. And from this, using the extensive data and using the knowledge about not only variants on their own, but how they're interrelated and held together by the process of linkage and recombination, that allowed us to distinguish differences between Devon and Cornwall, which I've always thought were, you know, highly closely related people. So when you go to enough depth, it's extraordinary how much you can find out more about those sorts of relationships. So I think that's the real major change that's happened. And not as much has been done, in my view, to be careful about how you sample the populations you study. Because a lot of the studies are there to look for genetic relationships with disease and don't think sufficiently carefully about the origin of where people came from, which you have to do. And then you can add to that the extraordinary technologies that have been developed for being able to study DNA from very old material. It still is a problem, but that allows you to try and relate some of the things you might discover, though you've got to interpret them carefully, from archaeological remains to the present situations. So my view is that the ideas are not hugely different. Of course, you have better ways of analyzing the data. You couldn't do anything without computers nowadays. But the fundamental ideas are not different, but the tools that you can use to apply them are hugely different.
Yeah, I mean, that sounds right. So, you know, you did mention the Peopling of the British Isles project. You know, this is like a huge project that spanned many, many decades, I think. And there was a paper in 2015 using the fine structure method. I think you were on that paper as well. There's a lot of interesting novel results. And so, you know, since you mentioned it, I want to ask you, like, what was, I mean, you mentioned Devon and Cornwall. I know that there was like a genetic cluster, I think, in the Midlands that might be associated with the Kingdom of Elmet, which is like a late Brythonic kingdom. I mean, just out of curiosity, you were heading this. What was the most surprising result for you out of this project?
The most surprising result, I'll tell you how it started. We had collected data from all over And at first, we didn't think we would be able to do it with an overall almost genomic coverage. We'd have to pick out selected markers. And we had done some early studies in the Orkney Islands, which are up to the north of the northeast of Scotland, and which were a Norse earldom and intermixed, therefore, with people whom you would now interpret to come from Norway. And we'd done these studies early, and it just occurred to me as I was looking at this data, gosh, some of those samples we've got, it looks as though they come from two different parts of Orkney. And maybe if we just plotted the data that we've got on the genetics against the geography, we'd find something out. Now, that was not a trivial thing to do, but when we did that, and we took just people clustered by how similar they were. So you divided the country in the end, it was something like 17 clusters, and each one of them was such that within those clusters, they were more similar to each other by these statistical tests of genetic variation than they were to any other cluster. And then we plotted the genetic data, no knowledge of where they were based on where they were plotted, on where those people came from. The correlation with the geography was absolutely astonishing. And I mentioned the Devon and Cornwall because that's something that people know about. The most distinct groups were found in Wales. The Orkney Islands clearly had the contribution from Norway that one might expect. And as you mentioned, there were variations within the centre of England that seemed to correlate to some of the sort of population groups that got together as political entities after the end of the Roman Empire. So it was that striking correlation between genetics and geography that you could only get by using a lot of genetic markers and, very importantly, by taking account of where they were in relation to each other, which is something we might discuss later, because that gives you a lot of extra information on the way that that variability is built up. And for instance, we had one sample that was said to be from Blackburn. Now, Blackburn is a town just near Manchester where I grew up, and yet it said that we'd collected these in somewhere in the northeast of Scotland, and it turned out there's another Blackburn up there. So actually, by the genetic differences are small, but collectively they're easily enough even to identify within the UK where someone might have come from.
Yeah, I mean, you know, from an American perspective, it's pretty fascinating because, you know, it's a big country. A lot of people, including people like me, like they moved to this country recently. You know, you trace the genealogies of these people in your data set. And, you know, it's like their ancestors are from this particular locality in England. And it's just fascinating. And I know some earlier work in the European continent shows that people could be traced to what village their family is from. And, you know, this in some ways might be a more common, way of just like in terms of existence, in terms of your lineage, although there are like, you know, population turnovers or whatnot, we know from ancient DNA. So it's complicated, but I guess the takeaway from that is the details matter in terms of understanding the context of the genetic structure that you see in front of you. So I want to jump back. Like we jumped forward to the post-genomic era and the 21st century. Let me just jump back really quickly. So you finished up your PhD, I think, in 1959, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so I mean, this was a particular time, just to set the scene for the listener. You know, we have Watson, Crick, Franklin, you know, Wilkins, all these people, early 1950s, DNA, you know, molecular revolution is really coming down the pipeline. But we also have a parallel track where, so, you know, W.D. Hamilton, I believe he was, you know, he was a graduate student around the same time. And he did not interact with Fisher, although he wished he did. I was curious, like, were you aware of any of Hamilton's work and what Hamilton and, you know, and like in terms of inclusive fitness, all these ideas at the time?
Well, first of all, let me take you back a step. Remember that the Watson-Crick discovery of the structure of DNA, I mean, one of the most remarkable discoveries of all time in biology, was in 1953. Jim Watson was a member of the college of which I was a member, but he left just before I came as an undergraduate. I first heard about DNA in a lecture that R.A. Fisher gave, who was a very close friend of Francis Crick's, and thought that Francis Crick should have succeeded him, I should say, as professor of genetics in Oxford. And it was a very good, precise description, followed by a whole lot of mathematics about how things worked in population genetics. So at that time, it was an extraordinary discovery, but there was no thought at all that it would be possible to do what has become possible, namely to use that in such a way that we can find out so much at the molecular level. So when you come to Hamilton, Hamilton was a student, an undergraduate, whom Anthony Edwards and I taught. And he was interested, Anthony and I wrote a paper on the effect of what factors evolutionarily affect the sex ratio, which is something that Fisher had raised. And Hamilton had picked up on that and asked us questions about that. So Hamilton's ideas came some years after my initial involvement and others' involvement in population genetics. And I later got to know him well. And his ideas were very, very important, essentially to look at how you could relate something that Holden and Fisher had said, that, you know, Holden once said he'd put down his life for, what was it, 8 cousins or something like that. So this idea of inclusive fitness that might explain aspects of small group selection was very important. But that came later. It was not related directly to much of my own work in population genetics, although it was a very important discovery to evolutionary ideas. Now, you ask about the excitement of molecular biology at that time. I got my PhD in 59. And I stayed on, had a research fellowship. I was fortunate in that respect, and wondering what to do next. And at that time, Fisher's successor as professor of genetics was John Thoday, who actually was behind some of the early work on what's now called, in some ways, polygenic inheritance studies. Mm-hmm. And it was actually Thoday who said, well, maybe you should consider learning more about molecular biology and going to somewhere where you could. And there was one of my colleagues who made the same comment. So I started thinking about that. And in fact, at one time, through Francis Crick's suggestion, I applied to work with Max Delbruck, which fortunately didn't work out, because I then took things into my own hand and decided to go and work with Joshua Lederberg. And the whole aim of that was to begin to be able to learn molecular biology, which is something quite different from what I'd done in the lab. And I have to say that you mentioned Lederberg got, of course, the Nobel Prize for discovering sex in bacteria, but he was an outstanding scientist. He was behind the idea of expert systems and artificial intelligence long before people were thinking about those sorts of things. He was an extraordinarily wide and influential person, and I've had the great experience of having as my mentors two of the best and most extraordinary scientists of the 20th century. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, that's incredible, the people you've interacted with. You know, it's, you know, I think like a lot of listeners out there with a biological background, it's like they hear these names or they read these names in the textbooks, and then like here I am like talking to someone who worked with them. These were living human beings that had wide range of interests, and they were complex, and it's fascinating to really to dig deep into that. I want to ask you real quick about Richard Lewontin wrote a piece, he wrote an article in the early 1970s, I believe, about how population genetics was in an interesting place because there were all these tools, but not that much data. So it was like, you know, it was like a mining device that just didn't have anything to mine. I think we're in a different stage right now, and now we'll get to that later. But, you know, there were a lot of theoretical models that were being produced in the 1970s, and sometimes I have opened up the physical copy of genetics before. I have looked at the archives, and, you know, there's all these two locus models. And so for the listener, you know, a locus is just like a region of the genome, part of the genetic map. So, you know, you have a gene at a specific location, and you have a gene at another location. And there's all these models about like how genes can evolve over time through selection, whether, you know, if they're dominantly expressed or not. And these two locus models, we're talking about dynamics, you know, assuming the two loci, right? And so these were a really big deal in the 1970s. And I don't feel like they're really explored anymore much. I'm asking, like, is this part of just the fact of like a finite amount of attention? And now with all this data, we've kind of ignored some of these theoretical avenues that were explored in decades past. What do you think about that?
I think you're absolutely wrong in what you say, and that they're not explored. Let me give a bit of the history of that, first of all. The earliest, what happens is if you've got genes that are closely linked together on the chromosomes, or they're physically closely linked together, and then they have variants in those genes, if the variants occur on two closely linked genes, they tend to be held together in the population, because they're only separated when you get recombination in the process that goes from parents to offspring. And Fisher actually was the first person really to discuss that verbally in a relatively short paragraph in his famous book, and pointed out that evolution could influence the position of genes next to each other according to how variants interacted with each other, that there should be an interaction between selection and linkage. And I became very interested in this, and with a colleague, Peter Parsons, actually wrote an extensive review on this, which was finished in 61. It wasn't published until a couple of years later, in which I took up the analysis of what happens to variants that are closely linked in populations if you put in a very general model of how selection can act on those on the genotypes, the genetic combinations that can be formed by alleles, genetic variants of two closely linked loci. Previous to that, there had been some analysis by Saul Wright, one of the great co-founders of population genetics. There had been some by Kimura, another famous population geneticist, and then Lewontin, who we just mentioned, whom I knew very well in his day. He died recently too. He with Kojima, they studied a particular type of model for that. But my study was intended to really look at it much more generally and to ask, you know, under what conditions would loci be held together? Under what conditions would they be brought together by linkage? And appreciated the importance of this. And that importance has remained. We haven't discussed my work and others, of course, on the what's called the HLA system and the whole idea of how you look for genetic variants that are associated with diseases. That whole notion, which came out of looking at variants in the histocompatibility HLA system and their association with disease, actually depends on the notion of linkage disequilibrium, of the association between the marker you're looking at and something close by that might really be the one that causes the thing that you're interested in. When people talk about selective sweeps, the idea that if you select for one gene, you pull along all the other genes with it that are closely linked, and you can detect that in your analysis of population differences. That also came out from the idea of working on linkage disequilibrium, as it's called, these associations initially in the HLA system. So it's an actually fundamental part of anything you do now in interpreting population studies. And as I've mentioned to you, what we did in the people of the British Isles study, it was only through taking into account the association between variants at closely linked loci that we were able to get the detailed description of population similarities that we did. Now, if you want me to talk about Lewontin and his work in the early 70s, that's a different story, which I'll talk about if you want.
Well, so he's not part of the questions, but since I am asking about historical figures, talk about Lewontin. I mean, very influential guy,
Lewontin came out with a paper in 1972 in which he pointed out that if you look at the variation, the genetic variation, there's much more variation, maybe 85% more within population groups than between. Right? In fact, that same idea had been put in a less clear way by Luca Cavalli in 1966, and I did a similar analysis 2 years or so after Dick Lewontin's publication, and I wasn't aware of what he'd done. Now, the trouble with Dick Lewontin was, who was an outstanding population geneticist and a very intelligent and a very nice person, I'd say, I knew him well, was that he mixed his political beliefs with his science, which I think is always a big mistake. So he started saying, oh, well, if this variation is so much within populations, the between doesn't matter, so we can't use it for identifying relationships between populations. And that was simply wrong, a point that Anthony Edwards has made very forcefully. The differences between populations that you can use in order to characterize quite closely related populations can be very small, but they do tell you that there are differences there. And some of those differences matter hugely with health indications. People talk about, you may have heard about, the sickle cell disease. It's a form of abnormal hemoglobin, the protein that carries oxygen around in the blood. And when you have that, you can suffer. If you have two bad versions, let's say, of that gene, you have an anemia, which is very serious, which killed off practically everybody in Africa where it occurred. So why was it there? The reason it was there is because if you've just got one copy of that bad gene, for various reasons, it protects you from malaria. And this actually is one of the most striking examples of an idea that came from Fisher's analysis, that you could maintain two different variants in a population if together they did better than either of them on their own when they were together with their similar partner. Heterozygote advantages, it's called. Mm-hmm. And things like that are extremely important. There are all sorts of differences between populations that actually do matter from a medical and health point of view. So to ignore the existence of these differences is doing an extreme disservice to different populations. And the trouble is that the idea that populations differ then gets mixed up with eugenic ideas and racism, which has got nothing to do and should have nothing to do with that. Your attitude towards people shouldn't depend on that. But if you want to pick people who are matched for a bone marrow transplant in the UK, it's no good studying white British people, because you won't be able to match up the people, the Afro-Caribbeans, or the people who came from India.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, so, you know, speaking of bone marrow and tissue matching and whatnot, a fair amount of your career has been, touched, and you mentioned it, HLA, the human leukocyte antigen. Can you talk about why HLA is important and why you've devoted a lot of your career, a substantial proportion to exploring this particular set of genetic loci?
Yeah. Well, let me start from the fact that I think most people would know now that if you want to, say, transplant a kidney from one person to another, if you start with a bit of skin, or if you do it with the bone marrow to replace the white blood cells, which determine your immunity, you can't do it between too many people, because there are genetic differences between people that are recognized as different as if you were getting a virus infection. And so they lead to the rejection by our immune system that protects us from disease. They lead to the rejection of the incoming tissue, which is genetically different. So people have, of course, they'd studied the differences on red cells. It turns out that some of those differences do matter. But they began to study the differences on the white cells of the blood. Now, the difference is that the white cells, the lymphocytes, are the cells that actually have a nucleus and are more representative of other cells in the body. And it had become clear that some of these differences that cause rejection of a graft would be found on the surface of white cells. So there were people at that time, Jan van Rood and John Dossey, and the collaborator that we had in Stanford, Rose Payne, who had done some initial work that showed that you could find antisera, you could find in the people, for instance, who had blood transfusions or in the mother serum, because she's recognized the differences between her and her children, which are due to the incoming genetic contribution from the fathers, that there were these differences, and you could begin to define them on white cells. And I had been very stimulated by Fisher's interpretation of one of the main red cell blood groups, the rhesus, that when I was approached by Rose Payne with a lot of data she had and couldn't understand, could I help her analyze it? I thought this is a wonderful thing to do. And it was actually the statistical analysis of these anti-sera and how they reacted together and so on that made a major contribution to the early identification of what came to be known as the HLA system. We were in there immediately behind the pioneers of it, Dose and Van Brood and others, and defined what is now called the HLA-A locus. And that whole system exploded very quickly because it was realized these were actually the differences you had to match for to get people to be transplanted. But more than that, they were shown to be in various ways key parts of your bodily system that can tell the way the immunity works. They can tell the way that you recognize a virus. That's what behind vaccination. It's through the immune system and the use of these HLA molecules that you actually recognize the difference on a cell that's infected by a virus from one that's not. So they proved to be enormously important in medicine. I mean, one of the most important discoveries, you might say, in some respects, in terms of its impact on understanding the immune system and transplantation. So once having started in that area, you found new variants, you found new loci that were different, that were all linked together, the same chromosome, you found out what the structures were, you could sequence them and so on. And so that became a major part of my work. And I should say the early data on HLA variation, which is huge, contributed in a major way to some of the later studies before the DNA field that Cavalli-Sforza and Edwards did in identifying different ethnic groups and their relationships to each other. Mm-hmm. It remains, I'm the last person alive of the, because I was the youngster in the group that initially defined it. And next month I'm going to the, is it the 18th workshop, international workshop? The only one I haven't been to was the first one, because at that time I was talking about our work at another meeting. It's a hugely important area still, and it's one that I'm now involved in a totally different way because of my interests in the way you can use the immune system to treat cancers.
Well, I mean, can you talk a little bit about, so thing with HLA is, you know, it's highly polymorphic. There's still some problems or utilizing next generation sequencing to identify it. And, you know, from an evolutionary perspective, HLA is pretty interesting, I think. Can you talk about it a little bit for the listener who, you know, obviously they know their tissue magic?
What's happened is that the HLA system has become complicated. So there are actually six major genes closely linked together. And the amount of variation is just not much. It's huge. It's by far the most variable part of the human genome, which itself is interesting because all that suggests that the reason that that variability is there is because it's probably evolved in the past to protect us from different waves of virus and bacterial and other pathogenic infections. So that the pattern of variation can, to some extent, tell you something about that. And that's what led behind trying to look for its association with diseases. The diseases it's most strongly associated with is where the immune system goes wrong, where it attacks your own body, as in type 1 diabetes, which destroys the pancreatic islet cells, the cells that make insulin and maintain your sugar levels appropriately and so on. So there's no real problem in sequencing the HLA system. If you do it properly, you can identify it down to the last detail. The difficulty is that there's so much variation that you need to know, well, is some aspect of the differences more important than others, for example, for matching for transplantation? And that does seem to be the case. And the different genes, they fall into two classes. One and two have different types of functions in the way that the immune system works. When you talk about the evolution, then you're talking, I mean, first of all, essentially all mammals have something equivalent to the HLA system. It varies a bit. The closer you go to the humans in the higher primates and then the lower primates, the more similar it is to what you find in humans, but it's there everywhere. And it's an interesting story that I don't think has been pursued quite enough to say, well, what are the origins if you look back before mammalian systems? You do find similar systems in the birds, and I'm not totally up to date on the latest ideas on how it might relate to what you'd find, say, in reptiles and so on. So there is an interesting evolutionary question there that undoubtedly parallels the whole evolution of our immune system, which is, of course, highly distinctive. And you don't find the similar immune system in plants. You find other ways in which they react to infection, but it's not like the immune system you find in mammals.
Yeah, no, it's a fascinating topic. You know, you got involved in it pretty early, and it's still an enormously fertile field. And we're just, genetics is more complicated than I think some people would have thought in some ways, and maybe less so in others. So I'm just like reading some online material. There's a lot about you. You've done a lot of work. It says that there's some claims that you were one of the first to suggest the idea of the Human Genome Project. Is that true?
Yeah, it's absolutely true. Yes. It's not always sufficiently much acknowledged, but it started with my giving the Allen Award lecture to the Human Genetic Society, to the Genetics Society in the States, where I started pointing out the way that you could use more information, the more you had it, to find out about genetic variation associated with diseases, to find out where genes that were, if you found a gene that segregated in a family for a disease, you might be able to use this technology, what became called positional cloning, to identify what the gene actually was, to look for the genes that are involved in changes in cancers and so on. Those ideas were beginning to be discussed very early in the 1980s, and I was certainly one of the first to push that, and the idea that you might want to sequence the whole genome. And then sort of only a few years later, there were various other avenues that came into discussing this, and there was a major meeting at the NIH in 1986, in the sort of middle of the summer, late summer, which I actually chaired, that was a major stepping off point for pushing the idea of doing the Human Genome Project. And at the time, people thought, oh, this is big science, it's going to use up all our money, and there's not going to be enough for the people that do their own little thing in the lab. And of course, it couldn't have been further from the truth, that because it was a huge stimulus to be able to sequence the human genome, and others, of course, to start with smaller. I mean, like Fred Sanger, who got a second Nobel Prize for how to sequence DNA, he sequenced a small virus. That was, in a way, the first living thing that was wholly sequenced. And it opened up the whole possibility of the way you could use this information in anything that you studied in terms of human biology or in terms of any biology. But people thought, oh, well, it was going to take away money from other research. It did quite the opposite. It brought it into them. And then there are people who said, oh, well, we don't know enough about genetics and disease. What use was it? Everything you do nowadays, you wouldn't have all that huge success, let's say, in getting a vaccine to work so quickly if you didn't have the background of the molecular biology that came out of doing the Human Genome Project. Mm-hmm. It was a huge stimulus. And I think that's been shown time and again. I think I'm a great believer, as you might know. I mean, one of my non-scientific, directly scientific activities has been to promote the public understanding of science and public engagement. And I think it's important that, and that was emphasized by the COVID pandemic.
Yeah.
I think it's very important that people understand something. And you can explain it, as you're doing and trying to get me to do, in ways that hopefully people can get an idea of what's going on. It's very exciting. It's part of our culture. And the more you understand it, the more you won't say, I don't want to be vaccinated, for example.
Yeah, which we have a problem with here in the States. So that's very on point. And like, just for some perspective, I believe the first SARS 20... almost 20 years ago now, you know, less than 20, but like the sequencing took, I think, like 4 to 5 months. And now, you know, it was done within days. So, you know, and we are sequencing constantly, yes. Figuring out new lineages.
Yes. And it's by the sequencing, that's the only way you'll pick up new variants.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we take it for granted now.
But I think it's important that people realize how much the sort of underlying basic biology was needed in order to make those advances. They're quite extraordinary. And it's the technology that enabled it. More than the ideas in a way are there, but it's the technology that made it possible. And it's an enormous achievement. And it's important to realize that. I find it very hard to understand people who are against vaccination. If they've got some allergy or something like that, okay, one can understand that. But this idea, which I think is notably there with the rather more right-wing public attitudes in the States to this, that, oh, well, you want freedom of right to do what you want, but you don't get vaccinated to protect yourself so much. You get vaccinated as a contribution to society to protect itself as a whole. So by not accepting vaccination, it's like saying I should be allowed to drive at 90 miles an hour along a motorway. Why not? You know, it's up to me if I kill myself. But by doing that, you're going to kill a few other people too.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, luckily, you guys in the UK have been pretty forward thinking and advanced in this whole field of vaccination. So, I mean, good for you.
Today, this morning.
Okay.
For the older people now.
Yeah, it is. I mean, everyone should. Yeah. I definitely endorse boosting. Everyone should do it. So, you know, Dr. Bodmer, we've been talking about the past a lot. And, you know, obviously, you know, you knew Fisher, Lederberg, you know, Luca, all of these people. But let's talk about the present and the future. You know, you're still an active researcher. You're still doing stuff. You're going to these conferences, as you said, the 18th of for the HLA. Like, what do you see proceeding forward? Like, you know, the Human Genome Project. So as we are recording, I just want to point out that they're closing up the final gaps in the human genome. The draft was published 20 years ago, but now incrementally they've spanned the last gaps. And so we got the map, at least a consensus of the map in human genetics. Low coverage sequencing is becoming very popular for non-human organisms. We're in a whole different world in terms of the amount of data we have. Like, what do you see going forward? Like, what are you excited about?
Well, first of all, let me say, I think there's been an awful lot of excessive hype about filling the gap in the sequencing. Because we've known about most of what really matters. I think the importance is not to do more sequencing as such, it's done all the time, but to apply this knowledge to understanding. And for instance, that's the only way you're going to really understand many of the major diseases. I mean, one of the main challenges in my mind is actually the difference between the mind and the brain, is how the brain functions. And it's a huge challenge, and there's a lot of knowledge at a certain level. But the difference, you know, I always, as an older person, I may not recall a name, but if someone mentions it, then I remember it. What's the difference? What's going on in the brain there? There's a huge amount there that we still need to understand. And the only way to contribute to that understanding is to use the basis of the underlying genetics, but of course with that comes all the ideas on what proteins are made, what bits of the genome can tell other bits of the genome, even though they don't make proteins. How does this work? What's the detail of how the differentiation into different cell types works? How can we use that in ways of better understanding aspects of disease? There's a huge amount still to be done there. And particularly, I would say, when it comes to mental disease and, you know, Alzheimer's. But we've still got a lot of way to go. I mean, I've stuck with cancer research myself. You know, I took it up as a geneticist when I was asked to in 1979, and I've stayed with it in a large way. There's still an awful lot to do. I mean, it's still, you know, the second major cause of death after heart disease. So there's still many things to do. And anything now that you do along those lines will depend in one way or another on the underlying genetics and what came from that, the knowledge of the different variations you can get from a gene by the way you make the messages, what the different proteins do, what different parts of the genome may be doing in controlling of expression, what you can do now at a single cell level. Inconceivable even 10 years ago that you could look at the DNA of single cells. You can take a sample of single cells from the normal bone marrow or the blood, and you can parse them. You can decide which type of cell is which by which messages they carry as individual cells. The technology is extraordinary, and it's applying that technology to things that we want to understand. I would include, I have to say, some things that people would think are not appropriate, but I think there's absolutely no doubt that there are important aspects of human behavior that have strong genetic components. And I think there are ways in which one can study that. I mean, the example I would always choose, because I was a mathematician and I like to play the piano, is it's inconceivable to think that the genius of someone like Mozart or Johann Sebastian Bach didn't have a genetic component. I mean, I used to give talks on this, and I'd say, well, maybe if Mozart had been brought up by a Bedouin tribe in the Sahara, he wouldn't have composed the way he did. But I'm absolutely sure if I'd been brought up in his family, I wouldn't have composed the way he did either. There has to be something that's inherited there. And the extreme mathematical ability, I mean, one of my great maths teachers, supervisors, as we called it in Cambridge, was Michael Atiyah, who sadly died recently, and he was one of the world's most outstanding mathematicians. That sort of ability, I could see, that's why I didn't become a mathematician. I could see there's no way I could have achieved what someone like that had. So my view is a little different from what people are doing, is not to study the overall level, but to really pick out the extremes and say, can we say something about how they are controlled genetically, where it's more likely we'll find that out? And then that might lead us into better understanding of what's going on at the molecular and biochemical level and what we can do about it if we understand it better.
Mm-hmm. Well, so, you know, you did share with me this paper, and I think I actually have read it. I am friendly with the first author, Dan Crouch, who you supervised a couple of years ago. Polygenic Inheritance, GWAS, Polygenic Risk Scores, and the Search for Functional Variants. And I think it is emphasizing what you were saying here. So some people, when they're looking at, you know, heritable variation and complex traits, whether it's behavioral or some quantitative disease trait, you know, there is a lot of discussion and focus on the normal variation. And what you're suggesting is, let's go look at the tails and look at what allelic combinations may be producing that, right?
Yes, that's a paper that I wrote with my colleague, whom I gather you've also talked to and know, a very, very able postdoctoral fellow and our colleague. And we wrote the part historical and partly current view on how to approach the study of quantitative variation, where you don't get very obvious differences, but you get a continuously varying thing like in height or weight. Which is such a complicated character anyway. And the challenge is really not to find more statistical ways of saying, well, there might be this much genetics or that much doing it, but actually to find the individual genetic variants that you can then take down to a molecular level that may control an aspect of that variation. And that's why I think studying the extremes, studying the things you can show are more heritable by studying twin studies and other ways of doing that. And then you might begin to get a clue, an inroad into that. So if you could find a variant that accounted for perfect pitch or certain types of musical ability, then maybe that would tell you more about when this variation that's less extreme than that, but nevertheless of interest, how that might be controlled by such genes as well. And I think that's very important. No one's going to deny it. You know, not everybody can become an athlete and break the, you know, the 10-second 100 yards. There it's known what sorts of variants can affect the way that the muscle deals with oxygen and so on.
Mm.
So I think it's very important to do that and not to sort of muddle it up with notions of you know, genetic differences in race and so on, but to try and understand so that we can then use the understanding better. I mean, the most important thing to do is to give everybody a decent education, whatever their abilities might be. That there's not much point in taking a tone-deaf person and trying to turn them into a musician.
Well, that's you know, that is a very common sense view. I really appreciate that. So, Dr. Bodmer, been you know, talking to you for a while, so I think we should close this out. I just want to thank you again for, you know, taking time out of your day to talk to us, and I really appreciate your remembrances of Fisher. You know, also you mentioned Lederberg. I mean, all of these people that you've encountered over the decades. It's just kind of like a history lesson in a single conversation, and I hope the listeners really appreciate it. I hope they check out your work. I hope they explore the man who R.A. Fisher was as well, instead of just, you know, whatever they see in the media or some petition. It's important to dig deep. It's important to think deeply, and, you know, proceed forward with the best information that we have. So I really appreciate your time, and thank you for talking.
It's a pleasure.
This podcast for kids.